Well, a very warm welcome to our service this morning, and we're sorry we can't meet in person, but I'm sure that we'll have a really good time. Let's just have a word of prayer. Dear God, I thank you for the technology that allows us to do such a thing. I pray that we have really good fellowship together wherever we may be. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to start with a hymn that is talking about faith. And in the Bible, it talks about without faith, it is impossible to please God. So let's start with our first hymn, 1262, By Faith We See the Hand of God.
Yeah. sight.
We will stand on as children of the promise, and that's what we want to do. We want to walk by faith and not by sight. And it's important in these times that we do that, isn't it? To have our faith, and we want to do that by our prayers as well. So let's come to prayer. Dear God, I thank you for your greatness, your sovereignty, and that you're in charge. Lord, we don't know what's in the future. We don't even know what's going to happen in the next few minutes, but you do, and we rest assured and are comforted by that fact. Dear Lord, you're a great and mighty God, a God who holds the universe as it is. Lord, we know the vastity and the complexity of the universe, and science is discovering even more. And Lord, we know the complexity and the smallness of the cells in our body, as we have learned so much over this pandemic about all sorts of things that happen in our bodies and the fight against the Omicron and all the other variants, Lord, and COVID. And thank you for the knowledge that you've given to the scientists, the doctors, the virologists, and all other people that have worked on these vaccines. And we thank you that many lives have been saved through this knowledge. Dear Lord, we do pray for those in our church at the moment. We think of Susanna and Jerry stuck out there on the Caribbean. I pray that they will have negative tests on Monday, they'll be able to come back. Pray that you'll be with them and help them. And Lord, pray for Dave and for Janet out in New Zealand in their isolation. Lord, I pray that you would help them to cope with that. Just a few days left now. I pray that you would, I thank you for the positivity that has come out from them, and we thank you for that, Lord, and we do think about them. And that's the greatness of prayer, that we can think of others around the world that we haven't seen for a long time, or that we can't see now because of time and space and because they're miles away. Lord, we thank you for, in that respect, for Janet and for Gordon in Romania. Pray that you'll keep them safe as well. And any that I failed to mention, I pray that you'll be with them. Pray for us all in the church, and thank you that you have kept us so well. And for those that are not feeling so well, maybe mentally and spiritually, I pray that you will come and visit them and help them. Now, Lord, as we come to your word in a few minutes, I pray that the Holy Spirit may come upon me in great power, and that the few feeble words that I may speak may be a comfort and encouragement to some, or an admonishment to others. I pray that you would help us to grow as a church here at Chailey. And thank you again for the fellowship, the love, and the joy that we have in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we're going to sing an old hymn, but it's very relevant, isn't it? I know not why God's wondrous grace.
Why God's one
to him against that day. I know not what of good or ill may be reserved for me, of weary ways or golden days before his face I see. And I know not when my Lord may come at night or noonday fair, nor if I'll walk the veil with him or meet him in the air. But I know whom I have believed in, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Yes, I know who I have believed in, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Yes, I know who I have believed in, and am persuaded.
Wonderful old hymn, isn't it? And it reminds me of another story I heard or read in a book about an old evangelist who came to Britain in the 1800s. There's lots of evangelists that came over. It wasn't Moody, but it was another chap. I can't remember his name, but that's not important. And they had a meeting at a church, and it was very prim and proper, middle-class church. And there was a young lady or middle-aged lady singing, and her voice was beautiful, and everything was very prim and proper. But the minister was a little bit disturbed, and he thought, well, I need to speak. So he spoke to the lady afterwards, and he didn't know why he wanted to do that. And he said, that was beautiful, beautifully sung, and your voice is beautiful. But do you know that you need the Lord Jesus Christ as much as the tramp outside and the beggar or the prostitute? And she was very offended, a middle-aged young lady. And she said, do you know that my father is the vicar here? Do you know who you're talking to? And she was very offended. And she went home in a bit of a temper. But that night she couldn't sleep. She got up in the night and committed her life to the Lord Jesus Christ and wrote this glorious, glorious hymn. Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. That lady was Charlotte Elliot, who is buried in Brighton, I believe. But that was a beautiful hymn that came out of that man talking to that person. So you don't know how God is going to use you. That's a marvellous, wonderful story, isn't it? Well, we're going to have our reading today, which is Matthew 2, verses 13 to 23. We're carrying on in Matthew's Gospel, and we're carrying on after Christmas. And it starts at verse 13, and is entitled, The Escape to Egypt. When they had gone, that's the wise men, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up, he said, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod. And so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. When Herod realized that he'd been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious. And he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity, who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time that he had learned from the Magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted, because they are no more. After Herod's death, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel. For those who are trying to take the child's life are dead." So he got up and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in Judah in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee and went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, that he should be called a Nazarene. May God bless his word to us. I'm going to have our third hymn now, which is "Jesus is the Name We Honour."
Jesus is the name we honor.
We're going to look at this passage now together and pray that God will bless it to us. Let's just have a word of prayer. Dear God, as we open your word and look at these words, I pray that you will give me the right words to speak and that everyone who is listening has prepared their hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. So this passage makes difficult reading, doesn't it? The first part shows the brutality of the time, and particularly the evil that Herod was capable of committing just to stay in power, or so he thought, because sadly he had mistaken whose Jesus' kingdom was about, as Pilate did later. He misunderstood Jesus' kingship and kingdom. So let's look at verses together and see what we can glean from these few verses. We need to start from verse 13, which is a good place to start, and show how this all knits together because Joseph did something very important. Verse 13 goes like this. When they had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up," he said. "Take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him." The first thing to note is that Joseph was receptive to God's guidance, as we considered before. He had opened the avenues and the ways of communication with God. It was his second dream and vision that Joseph received from God. Joseph's first dream revealed that Mary's child would be the Messiah. We read about that before, didn't we? In chapter 1, verses 20 to 21. His second dream told him how to protect the child's life. Although Joseph was not Jesus' natural father, he was Jesus' legal father and responsible for his safety and well-being. He was willing to listen to divine guidance. And it comes only if we're prepared, with prepared hearts. Joseph remained receptive to God's judgment. God's guidance. He opened the avenues of communication. So the first question I want to ask in a practical way is, what of us? Are we in tune with God? Have we opened the lines of communication? This is done through his written word and his spoken word and direct access to him. Because of the saving blood of his son, we can do like the writer to the Hebrews say, we can come boldly to the throne of grace. We can go there and we ask God to speak to us and to listen to what he has to say. Or do we just sit on our hands and wait for him to act while not opening any lines of communication? Isn't that a bit unfair? This new year, let us that be our resolution, to seek God and ask for his guidance and listen out for his reply. Let's expose ourselves to his will for our lives. Let's keep on asking him the questions needed to live a fulfilled life in him. I have a granddaughter that asks lots of questions. I had a daughter that asked lots of questions. She's now a pharmacist. At the time, it became a bit difficult to answer all her questions. Why? But actually, she learnt lots from that. And that's what we need to do. We need to ask God to keep asking, to keep listening to what he has to say. And God wants us to ask him. He wants us to come to him and ask him for everything. Ask and you shall receive, he says. Let's keep that line of communication open that Joseph obviously did. He was sensitive to what God was saying. Now, we will look at verses 14 and 15 a little later. But first, let us deal with the difficult verses of 16 to 18. When Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious and gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. Then What was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning. Rachel is weeping for her children and refuses to be comforted because they are no more. This passage is a stark reminder that we're living in a sinful world, in which even the innocent suffer, and often the innocent suffer. As we see pictures of wars and conflicts, most of those pictures are showing the hurt and the distress of those innocents. So we mourn for the sin in this world that has caused this. But why did Herod kill those probably 20 to 30 babies in Bethlehem? Why did he do it? Well, I've hinted of this earlier, but Herod, the king of the Jews, killed all the boys under 2 years old because he was an obsessive attempt to kill Jesus, the newborn king. He stained his hands with the blood of all those innocent children, but he did not harm Jesus. Herod was king by a human appointment by the Romans, but no one could thwart King Jesus and God's plans. Herod was afraid that this newborn king would one day take his throne. He completely misunderstood the reason for Christ's coming. Jesus didn't want Herod's throne. He wanted to be king of Herod's life. Jesus wanted to give Herod eternal life, not take away his present life. And the sad thing is, today, people are often afraid that Christ wants to take everything away, when in reality, he wants to give them real freedom, peace, and joy. My plea is, don't fear Jesus. Give him the throne of your life. For with it, he will give you that peace and joy and contentment in whatever situation you'll be in. He'll be with you, alongside you. He'll be there with you. And through the Holy Spirit will help you through those difficult times. And he also has a great work for you, and an even better life for this life and for eternity. Then there's those verses in 17 and 18, which is a prophecy from Jeremiah. And verse 18 needs a little explaining. The voice is heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted because they are no more. It's a prophecy of Jeremiah. And Ramah is another name for Bethlehem. And the weeping and mourning, Rachel was mentioned because that is where she had her last child, Benjamin, when she died. And it was known as Rachel's last place that she was. And in this prophecy, Jeremiah was looking forward and looking to this event and was mourning because of what was going to happen because of the evilness of this king. And it must have been horrible for the people of that day, the suffering and the anguish. And it's something that we should always consider when we consider this world's problems. And it all relates back to that sin that was committed in the Garden of Eden and has been embedded in the hearts of men and women since. So we all bear a blame for this. But we pray against it, and God is a loving God and often steps into these situations. So let's glance back to verse 14 and read it, because this is important. So he'd been warned by God, Joseph, that he must leave, that Herod had wanted to kill his baby. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod, and so fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. The first thing is, the prophecies that have been in the Old Testament were being fulfilled here. But in the Hebrew times, the writer mentions many times in the Hebrews. In the book of Hebrews, the writer mentions many times the role of Jesus as our high priest, who would empathize with us in all our sufferings. There's lots of different references in Hebrews, if you read it through, about the way that the high priest would have been there, had done all these things, could empathize with us, and could sympathize with everything in our sufferings and temptations. And this passage shows that he could empathize with those who are disposed and refugees. And it's a very topical topic at the moment, isn't it? Refugees. So I looked up the disturbing facts about refugees. And in our so-called enlightened world, it's a sober thought, is that these figures that I collected and collated here were by the end of 2020. So I should imagine, I'm sure, that they're even worse than what's happened since. So these are the figures, and they are quite horrific. So bear with me. According to UNHCR, which is the UN Refugee Agency, there are 26.4 million refugees, with about half under the age of 18. But that is only half of the story. 68% of those come from just six countries. From Syria, 4 million. From Venezuela, 2.6. From Afghanistan, 2.6. From South Sudan, 2.2. And from Myanmar, 2.1. Of the European countries, the major hosting countries are Turkey with 3.7 million refugees. 3.7 million. And Germany with 1.2 million. And there were at that time 4.1 million asylum seekers. And only 14% of these are in developed countries. Most are in neighbouring countries. But worse than this is that there were, at the end of 2020, 82.4 million people forcibly displaced, which had risen from 2015 from 60 million. Which means that there were one in every 95 people on earth that have fled their homes. So the question we need to ask ourselves is not why are we helping these people, but how can we help these people more effectively? As well as our prayers, may we all find a way to help these people. And never let us moan about our lot when so many people are suffering in the world that God has told us to look after. It's sobering, isn't it, to think of these great numbers. So with our resolution to seek God's will this year, may it also be a resolution to see how we can help these people, how we can be effective in the way that we help these people, in whatever way that we can. So finally, we come to the last part of this passage, which is in verses 19 to 23. And this final section of our passage today shows God's sovereign control and plan cannot be thwarted, however, whoever tries. So a little bit background history here is needed, I think, of Herod. Herod died in B.C. 4, suggesting that Jesus was a refugee for about 2 to 3 years. He died, according to the historians of the time, of an incurable disease. Now, Rome trusted him, but didn't trust his sons. And Herod knew that Rome wouldn't give his successors as much power, so he divided his kingdom into three parts, one of each of his sons, Achelous, received Judea, Samaria, and Idumea. Herod Antipas received Galilee and Persia. And Herod Philip II received Trenticus, wherever that is. Now, Acralius, or whatever is however you pronounce that name, I pronounce it three times differently now, but you know, was a violent man. History will tell us. If his father was violent, he was 10 times worse. He began his reign by slaughtering 3,000 influential people. And 9 years later, he was banished by the Roman Empire. Even that very brutal empire couldn't stand this man and his brutality and his violence. So God didn't want Joseph's family to go into that region of this evil ruler. Joseph was again listening to God, wasn't he? Even though it was a difficult decision. It says in verse 22, when he heard that Achillas was reigning in Judea in the place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee, and he went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, that he would be called a Nazarene. It was a difficult decision, because it was obvious he didn't want to live in Nazareth. They had put their home down in Bethlehem. We don't know how many, maybe a year or so, they'd been in Bethlehem before this incident happened. They had a house, because it said that the Magi visited the house where they were. So they'd settled down. He probably started his carpentry company there. And now he was having to go back to Nazareth, where they had come from. Now, why was that difficult? He'd been in Bethlehem, and he started a business there, but he was going back to his hometown. Surely that was easy. But no, it was difficult for him. He had to go to a difficult place because there they would have remembered his history. The people knew him. There were questions. There were rumors about a pregnancy. They were counting up the months and thinking, hang on, this isn't right. This child is X amount of years old. And, you know, I'm sure they didn't get married before that. So there would have been a lot of problems going back. But Joseph listened to God, even though it was a difficult decision, going back to Nazareth. Maybe just think, sometimes God's people have to make difficult decisions. And I think we need to just listen like Joseph and then be given courage to act on what we're hearing. Sometimes God gives us difficult things to do, but if he does, it always gives us the tool to cope with them. So help us to listen like Joseph through the lines of communication to what God is telling us to do, and then to act on it. I just want to finish by reading another old hymn. This is 269. And it's this. I do not know what lies ahead, the way I cannot see. Yet one stands near to be my guide. He'll show the way to me. I know who holds the future, and he'll guide me with his hand. With God, things don't just happen. Everything by him is planned. So as I face tomorrow, with its problems large and small, I'll trust the God of miracles. Give to him my all. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I do thank you for the example of Joseph. I thank you for the reminder that you are a sovereign God. We thank you for the reminder of your everlasting kingdom. And we shudder and cringe at the thought of what sin can do. Lord, we thank you that you are a sovereign God in control of this world, even though at times it seems that you aren't. Pray to give us this faith to go forward and trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to finish by singing our last hymn, Love Before the Dawn of Time.
Loved before the dawn of time, chosen by my Maker, hidden in my Savior, I am His and He is mine, cherished for eternity. When I'm staying with guilt and sin, He is there to lift me, heal me and forgive me, gives me strength to stand again, stronger than I was before. So with
now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.